Welcome back to Crimson Crochet House. This is Jessica, and I am going to give you my entire lesson for the beginning crochet class that I used to teach for the city. A little bit of background about myself. I taught crochet for 2 years for the city of West Lafayette, and prior to that had crocheted for 28 years. And I am just happy to be teaching again, but I don't really feel like having a class outside of the home because I have an infant, and I'd much rather do something like this. But I know that feedback is important, so if you ever get stuck in any of my lessons or you need help, just post a comment. I respond to them right away because I know how frustrating it is to be stuck. This is the first lesson in beginning crochet. You can print out the pattern and the link in the description of my video below. It is called the Bow Headband, which is the first project. You can literally go from not knowing how to crochet at all to walking away with a headband. The supplies you need are very simple, and I've posted links to each one below. You can also find them in local craft stores. If you do use my links to purchase them, thank you very much. Amazon gives me a few cents because you placed your purchase with me. Doesn't cost you anything, but it is nice to give free lessons and get a little bit of incentive to buy more materials. I am using a Deborah Norville Collection Everyday Soft Worsted Weight Yarn. You can use any worsted weight yarn for this project, but how do you know that it's worsted weight? If you turn the label over, you will see on the yarn that it has a little legend. And the legend, as you can see, has the number 4. Number 4 is a medium worsted weight yarn. That's what you're looking for. The hook we need is also listed on this yarn, and it is the size I9 hook or 5.5 millimeter. When in doubt, always use the 5.5 millimeter sizing, because at some point, way back in history, they resized hooks. So you may be using an old hook if you got like supplies from somebody else and you're trying her out. So just make sure that it's 5.5 millimeters. That's all we really care about. I would also suggest that you pick a yarn that is light in color. Learning to crochet, it's really important that you are able to see all of the details of your stitching, because you won't know what you're doing at first. And darker yarns, it can kind of sometimes be harder to see the details of the stitch. You can move on to dark yarns after you get a hang of what the pattern is supposed to look like. Now, we talked a little bit about getting the right size hook, but how do you know you have the right size hook? This hook is a size I hook. You can see on it, it says USI9/5.5 millimeters. And that's all you really need. This is a Susan Bates hook. I am about to teach you the hardest part of crochet, and after you get this, you will be completely past all the hard stuff. The rest of it's just practice. Oh, I'm sorry, you also need what's called a yarn darner, which is a needle with a blunt end that has an eye big enough to put yarn in. They can be called tapestry needles, yarn darners, it doesn't matter. Just pick out a needle that's got an eye big enough for the yarn to go through and an end that is blunt tipped. And it's kind of thick. And a pair of scissors. That's it. That's all you need. Now, to start your crochet project, more times than not, I'd say about 99% of the time, you're going to need what's called a slip knot to put the yarn onto your hook. A slip knot's pretty simple in concept. You're just making a circle out of the yarn, like that. Here, let me make one a little further down to the yarn. A circle out of the yarn, and then you take the end, and instead of pulling this end through, leave it out, and just pull the knot tight around the loop. Now that's a really big one, but we can pull this end, you see, and it slips into size. That's why it's called a slip knot. Then you can just put your hook on and tighten it up to the hook. You want your slip knot to be in between the thumb grip, where the sizing's printed, or the manufacturer name, whatever, and what's called the throat of the hook. The throat is where it's smaller than the 5.5 millimeter gauge. This has a use, and you'll see as we crochet. This is the head of the hook. and the ends may look different. This one is pointed. Now, when you make your slip knot, leave a long tail. Matter of fact, I always say err on the caution and make a tail way longer than you think you need. It doesn't hurt, and you're not going to run out of yarn by the length of your tail. It doesn't hurt, and it could help a whole lot, and you'll see why. If you need help making the slip knot, rewind the video and try again. Just don't pull your end all the way through, and you should be good. Now, the hardest part of learning to crochet is learning how to hold your yarn and hook while crocheting. And it's gonna feel awkward because you haven't done it before. So, put your hook on the table. If you are left-handed, reverse and put your hook on the other side and put your left hand and do the exact same thing I'm doing. I'm right-handed. So, you can also learn on your right hand if you're close to being ambidextrous. A lot of left-handed people I know can do a lot of stuff with their right hand because the world's developed that way. But if you're very strongly left-handed, just switch hands and do the exact same thing I'm doing. You take your pinky finger and wrap it under the yarn. And so you've made a loop on your pinky. Then you'll take your pointer finger and wrap it around the yarn. So you've got a loop around your pinky and your pointer finger. That's what it looks like on the back. The proper thing to do when holding, you don't actually hold your hook at all with your left hand, but you will hold where that slip knot is so that you can move it around. Where your thumb and middle finger are is going to be where your work is while you're crocheting. You can use your right hand to tighten up the yarn that's getting loose. And what you've got is an area here to pull yarn onto your hook. Your pinky can tighten here to affect the tension of the yarn as it pulls through. And your pointer holds it up in a way and also adjusts the size of the knot on the hook, which we'll look at here in a minute. Again, wrap the pinky, wrap the pointer. It's gonna feel awkward, and that's okay. The reason why we don't just wrap the pointer, which most people wanna go into, is because then you don't have anything adjusting your tension, and it's hard to make your stitches all the same size. Then you have to close your whole hand to adjust your tension. And there are certain stitches you cannot do without having the proper hold on your yarn, so wrap pinky, wrap pointer, and hold with thumb and middle finger on the knot. Now, go ahead and put your hook under the yarn and pull it through the loop on the hook. If you're finding this hard to do, it's probably because the loop on the hook is hard to pull through. If you're finding that you're doing a lot of this and not getting anywhere, make it easy on yourself and pull out your loop a little bit. Remember, this is adjustable. Just use your big finger to close it up and pull your hook out to make it bigger. So loosen it up a little bit and you can slide right on through there. This is called a chain stitch. It looks kind of like a braid. This is the foundation stitch for most crochet projects. As you stitch, move your middle finger and thumb up to have more control over your stitch. And pull through. And you know what? Most times your foundation stitch needs to be looser anyway because more stitches are going to go in here. So if your stitches are really tight and close together and you can't pull them apart, you're not going to be able to get your hook back in there later. And you really need to do that. Stitch. And you can just keep on doing this until you feel comfortable. If the yarn starts to get loose in here, and you're having a hard time picking it up and it's all loose in your hand, just stop, drop everything. This isn't going anywhere, you've already done the work. Wrap your pinky, wrap your pointer, grab on and continue. And you notice how I move my thumb and middle finger to hold on to the stitch that I make and move the hook around. It's helping my hook keep close to my work. If I were to keep making stitches and not move my middle finger and thumb, it would get really far away from me and get pretty difficult for me to control the size of my stitch. So just don't worry. You don't need to hang on to this. It's fine. It's already done. It's not going anywhere. And if your hook falls out, no big deal. If it falls out and the stitch is like this and you're like, oh no, don't worry. Just pull those stitches out and give yourself a little room and stick your hook back in there and keep going. It will take practice, but keep doing this slip stitching until you feel comfortable doing it. It might take a little while, and that's fine. And there are actually some really beautiful projects that are just done with a slip stitch, and I'll show you some of those later on in life. I'll give you some references to some stitch patterns and whatnot. But it looks like braid. For this project, when you have printed off the pattern, you will see that the first instruction is to take your yarn and chain 13, and that is a slip stitch, a chain. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Now, it could be that you have been stitching away for a while and you've unwrapped it a few times and they don't look very, like the beginning of your project doesn't look as good as where you finished, and that's natural because you've been practicing, and as you practice, you'll get better. So the end of your project may look really bad. You know what? You don't need this. It may be getting a little raggedy and nasty and whatnot, so just cut off what you've done, throw it away, and start over. For that reason, I always tell my beginning students, please don't buy nice, brand new, pretty, expensive yarn to start learning to crochet. Because chances are, if you spent a lot of yarn and made a beginner project out of it, and it didn't look the way you wanted it to at the end, which it probably won't, because the beginning of your project will probably look a little weird, and the end of it will look pretty good. Not something you'd want to spend a lot of money on, however. You can learn this pattern, be comfortable with it, and then go out and buy some really pretty yarn and make as many of these as you want. But learn on something not too expensive. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. I have a chain of 13. Now, we've been working this way. We're actually going to stop and work back over the top of our braid. We are going to single crochet in our chain. And it says to single crochet in the second chain from the hook. Now what that means is our hook has a loop on it. That doesn't count. This would be the first chain, but if I stuck my hook in here and pulled this tight, it would just come undone. And then I'd have less chains than I need. So we don't want to go in the first chain. We want to go in 1, 2. We're going to take our hook and we're going to put it in the top loop of our foundation chain in the second chain. We're going to put our hook over top of the yarn and pull through a loop. You should have two loops on your hook now, and the chain you put your hook into will be kind of big. That's okay. It'll even out as you work. Put your hook under again and pull through both loops on your hook. That is a single crochet. Now, your foundation chain looks kind of funny because you've got all of this in here and we stretched it out a little bit. Don't worry, when we go on the next one, this one will even out and so on. Now, we're going to work a single crochet in every stitch across the chain. We don't want to go in here. We were just there. And you can tell two ways. One, there's lots of yarn in it. And two, the hole's bigger. So we take our hook and we go in the top loop of the next chain. Slide it up. That helps widen your loop. It gives you more space to work. The reason why we go over top and pull down and not under and pull down. is because, well, you can really do it either way. It depends on what's more comfortable to you. When I'm working a more complicated stitch, I will go under. But going over does the same thing. So in some stitches, it will make a difference. In this one, not so much. But make sure you pay attention if you're told to go over or under a particular one, because it does actually make a difference in how easy it is to do. If you're having trouble doing it one way, do it the other way and see if it's easier. I go over because the yarn wraps around the back of the hook and doesn't get in my way when I pull it down. If I go under, the yarn's right here, and if the work's turned too much, it's hard to pull it through. So over keeps it from getting in front. Over the top, pull one loop through, push down on our shaft to widen these loops up to the size they need to be, yarn over, and pull through both loops on the hook. And now this one's all big, and look how the other one is shrunk down to where you can't even tell where you went in. That's the way it's supposed to be. Go to the next chain, put your hook in, yarn over, and pull through two. That is a single crochet, and you're already crocheting. Now, use your thumb and middle finger to help you hold the work where you need it to be to make it easy. It doesn't matter how much you pull on this stuff. I guarantee you, you can yank on this. If you drop your hook, no big deal. Pick it up, put it back in, tighten it, rewrap, and keep on going. All right? If you get confused about where you are, just stop. Pull it apart, say, okay, this is big, that's where my stitch went. Go in the next one. Please don't panic. It's only practice. And you're probably sitting there saying to yourself, my stuff doesn't look like her stuff. I don't know if I'm doing it right. My stuff looks all weird and big, or my stuff looks all tiny and tight. Usually, 90% of the time, most of my beginning students need to loosen how much they work and not tighten. I think maybe it's the stress of learning something new that makes them want to tighten everything up, and then their stitches are so tight they're having to cram the needle into their work and just really stressing themselves out. So when in doubt, loosen it all up and just keep going. You can try these steps as often as you need to. Just cut off the yarn and start again. And next, you've got all the way to the end. Now, in parentheses on the first step of our pattern, it says you have 12 stitches, and you want to make sure you actually have 12 stitches. The first stitch is kind of hard because it's curved at the end. That's normal. If you look at the top, you'll see a braid, and you can count the braids. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. You don't count the one on the hook. You can also count posts, but it's kind of hard in the beginning because this one does count, but it looks wider than the others because it's the end. But 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, see how the posts have blank holes between them? 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I've had some students ask me, is it important to count? It is incredibly important to count, especially in the beginning, because you're not quite sure what the end and the beginning of the rows are supposed to look like. And if you don't have the exact same amount of stitches in every row, what you're going to end up with is a pattern where the edges go like this. And they may go narrower, and then wider, and then narrower, and it won't look very good. Now, it's all going to take practice, so don't beat yourself up too much. Your first headband may be terrible, and then you get the hang of it and go, oh, that's what I was supposed to be doing, and you start another one that looks great. When you get to the end of your row, you are going to chain one, just like we did when we were making the foundation row. Pull through one. The reason is because we need to go up a little bit to start the next row. If we started right from the bottom, not only would we probably end up accidentally undoing our work a little bit, but it would also be curved at the end. It wouldn't be a nice square that we need. After you chain one, turn the work around. And we're going to work back the other direction, just like we did when we started making our single crochet. Now we're ready to start row two. And as you can see, row 2 through 72 are all exactly the same. so you don't have to memorize a lot of steps. We're going to be doing the exact same thing for 72 rows, and you will get lots and lots of practice. Now, this first chain is the one we just made. We don't work in here because it's just a chain. We're going to work in the single crochets that are on the first row. Now, you take your hook and you put it through the top of the stitch. Now, when you do this, you know how the top of it looks like a braid? You're going to have a front loop and a back loop, and they're both going to be on your hook. You're basically picking up the top of that braid and putting it right on your hook. And you'll do that all the way across. So you'll keep working single crochets the way we learned, only now instead of sticking your hook in a single chain, you're putting it in the top of every stitch. So you put your hook in there, you yarn over and pull through one, and you have two loops on your hook. Yarn over and pull through two loops, and there's a single crochet on top of a single crochet. Again, yarn over, go to the next stitch, look at it from the top, put your hook in, and you will actually have, don't yarn over first. Put your hook through the stitch in the beginning. You've got nice pretty braid on there. Yarn over, pull through one. Yarn over, pull through two. You have another single crochet. Go into the next stitch, put the braid on your hook. Yarn over, pull through one. Yarn over, pull through two. You're going to go all the way across your row. And it may be difficult, and trust me, the beginning of any crochet project always doesn't look like much of anything. And you've got yourself wondering, it doesn't look like I'm making what I'm supposed to be making. Don't worry, stick it out. When you do enough of the rows, it will begin to look like something. It will start to have a pattern. And the first couple of rows are always the very hardest to work. So I'm kind of glad that this project only has 12 stitches across each row, because then it would be even harder to get started. At the end, that last stitch is kind of hard to work in. Remember, it's the curved one from the first row because it was on the other side where we started. And you'll be wondering, do I have enough stitches? It doesn't look like I should go in here, but I don't feel like I have enough stitches. You probably don't. Let's give them a count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. We do need to do that last one. This is why counting is important. And getting this top last braid on your hook will take a little more effort. And it'll feel wrong, but it'll be right. Once you finish that one, oh yeah, I can see now. And you chain one and turn the work around again. And that edge will be nice and square. You'll skip that first chain, go in the stitch, and you'll keep on working. And you will do this for 72 rows. You might be thinking to yourself, okay, I know how to count stitches, but how do I know where rows are? Good question. It is kind of hard to see. But if you stretch your work, you can see for yourself, there are gaping holes between your rows. One, two, and now we're on the third row. If you have a hard time counting, you can count how many rows you do, and then like put a little safety pin at the beginning of like the row you just did so you know how many you've done. You can do it in sections of 5, sections of 3, sections of 10, whatever's more comfortable to you. But learning how to count rows is important. Go ahead, continue this pattern until you have 72 rows, and then I will show you how to fasten off, which is basically the way that you quit making a particular piece and make it so it cannot come undone. And then we'll make the part for the bow, and then we will put them together. So just keep working on that. And you know what? Most times your foundation stitch needs to be looser anyway, because more stitches are going to go in here. So if your stitches are really tight and close together and you can't pull them apart, you're not going to be able to get your hook back in there later. And you really need to do that. And you can just keep on doing this until you feel comfortable. If the yarn starts to get loose in here, and you're having a hard time picking it up and it's all loose in your hand, just stop. Drop everything. This isn't going anywhere. You've already done the work. Wrap your pinky, wrap your pointer, grab on, and continue. And you notice how I move my thumb and middle finger to hold on to the stitch that I make and move the hook around. It's helping my hook keep close to my work. If I were to keep making stitches and not move my middle finger and thumb, it would get really far away from me and get pretty difficult for me to control the size of my stitch. So just don't worry. You don't need to hang on to this. It's fine. It's already done. It's not going anywhere. And if your hook falls out, no big deal. If it falls out and the stitch is like this and you're like, oh no, don't worry. Just pull those stitches out and give yourself a little room and stick your hook back in there and keep going. But it looks like braid. For this project, when you have printed off the pattern, you will see that the first instruction is to take your yarn and chain 13, and that is a slip stitch, a chain. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Now, it could be that you have been stitching away for a while and you've unwrapped it a few times and they don't look very, like the beginning of your project doesn't look as good as where you finished, and that's natural because you've been practicing, and as you practice, you'll get better. So the end of your project may look really bad. You know what? You don't need this. It may be getting a little raggedy and nasty and whatnot, so just cut off what you've done, throw it away, and start over. For that reason, I always tell my beginning students, please don't buy nice, brand new, pretty, expensive yarn to start learning to crochet. Because chances are, if you spent a lot of yarn and made a beginner project out of it, and it didn't look the way you wanted it to at the end, which it probably won't, because the beginning of your project will probably look a little weird, and the end of it will look pretty good. Not something you'd want to spend a lot of money on, however. You can learn this pattern, be comfortable with it, and then go out and buy some really pretty yarn and make as many of these as you want. But learn on something not too expensive. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. I have a chain of 13. Now, we've been working this way. We're actually going to stop and work back over the top of our braid. We are going to single crochet in our chain. And it says to single crochet in the second chain from the hook. Now what that means is our hook has a loop on it. That doesn't count. This would be the first chain, but if I stuck my hook in here and pulled this tight, it would just come undone. And then I'd have less chains than I need. So we don't want to go in the first chain. We want to go in 1, 2. We're going to take our hook and we're going to put it in the top loop of our foundation chain in the second chain. We're going to put our hook over top of the yarn and pull through a loop. You should have two loops on your hook now, and the chain you put your hook into will be kind of big. That's okay. It'll even out as you work. Put your hook under again and pull through both loops on your hook. That is a single crochet. Now, your foundation chain looks kind of funny because you've got all of this in here and we stretched it out a little bit. Don't worry, when we go on the next one, this one will even out and so on. Now, we're going to work a single crochet in every stitch across the chain. We don't want to go in here. We were just there, and you can tell two ways. One, there's lots of yarn in it, and two, the hole's bigger. So we take our hook and we go in the top loop of the next chain. Slide it up. That helps widen your loop. It gives you more space to work. So over the top, pull one loop through. Push down on our shaft to widen these loops up to the size they need to be. yarn over, and pull through both loops on the hook. And now this one's all big, and look how the other one is shrunk down to where you can't even tell where you went in. That's the way it's supposed to be. Go to the next chain, put your hook in, yarn over, and pull through two. That is a single crochet, and you're already crocheting. Now, use your thumb and middle finger to help you hold the work where you need it to be to make it easy. It doesn't matter how much you pull on this stuff. I guarantee you, you can yank on this. If you drop your hook, no big deal. Pick it up, put it back in, tighten it, rewrap, and keep on going. All right? If you get confused about where you are, just stop, pull it apart, say, okay, this is big, that's where my stitch went. Go in the next one. Please don't panic. It's only practice. And you're probably sitting there saying to yourself, my stuff doesn't look like her stuff. I don't know if I'm doing it right. My stuff looks all weird and big, or my stuff looks all tiny and tight. Usually, 90% of the time, most of my beginning students need to loosen how much they work and not tighten. I think maybe it's the stress of learning something new that makes them want to tighten everything up, and then their stitches are so tight they're having to cram the needle into their work and just really stressing themselves out. So when in doubt, loosen it all up and just keep going. You can try these steps as often as you need to. Just cut off the yarn and start again. And next, you've got all the way to the end. Now, in parentheses on the first step of our pattern, it says you have 12 stitches, and you want to make sure you actually have 12 stitches. The first stitch is kind of hard because it's curved at the end. That's normal. If you look at the top, you'll see a braid, and you can count the braids. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. You don't count the one on the hook. I've had some students ask me, is it important to count? It is incredibly important to count, especially in the beginning, because you're not quite sure what the end and the beginning of the rows are supposed to look like. And if you don't have the exact same amount of stitches in every row, what you're going to end up with is a pattern where the edges go like this. And they may go narrower, and then wider, and then narrower, and it won't look very good. Now, it's all going to take practice, so don't beat yourself up too much. Your first headband may be terrible, and then you get the hang of it and go, oh, that's what I was supposed to be doing. And you start another one that looks great. When you get to the end of your row, you are going to chain one, just like we did when we were making the foundation row. Pull through one. The reason is because we need to go up a little bit to start the next row. If we started right from the bottom, not only would we probably end up accidentally undoing our work a little bit, but it would also be curved at the end. It wouldn't be a nice square that we need. After you chain one, turn the work around, and we're going to work back the other direction, just like we did when we started making our single crochet. Now we're ready to start row two. As you can see, row 2 through 72 are all exactly the same, so you don't have to memorize a lot of steps. We're going to be doing the exact same thing for 72 rows, and you will get lots and lots of practice. Now, this first chain is the one we just made. We don't work in here because it's just a chain. We're going to work in the single crochets that are on the first row. Now, you take your hook and you put it through the top of the stitch. Now, when you do this, you know how the top of it looks like a braid? You're going to have a front loop and a back loop, and they're both going to be on your hook. You're basically picking up the top of that braid and putting it right on your hook. And you'll do that all the way across. So you'll keep working single crochets the way we learned. Only now, instead of sticking your hook in a single chain, you're putting it in the top of every stitch. Put your hook through the stitch in the beginning. You've got a nice pretty braid on there. Yarn over, pull through one. Yarn over, pull through two. You have another single crochet. Go into the next stitch. Put the braid on your hook, yarn over, pull through one, yarn over, pull through two. You're going to go all the way across your row, and it may be difficult, and trust me, the beginning of any crochet project always doesn't look like much of anything. and you've got yourself wondering, it doesn't look like I'm making what I'm supposed to be making. Don't worry, stick it out. When you do enough of the rows, it will begin to look like something. At the end, that last stitch is kind of hard to work in. Remember, it's the curved one from the first row because it was on the other side where we started. And you'll be wondering, do I have enough stitches? It doesn't look like I should go in here, but I don't feel like I have enough stitches. You probably don't. Let's give them a count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. We do need to do that last one. This is why counting is important. And getting this top last braid on your hook will take a little more effort. And it'll feel wrong, but it'll be right. Once you finish that one, oh yeah, I can see now. And you chain one and turn the work around again, and that edge will be nice and square. You'll skip that first chain, go in the stitch, and you'll keep on working. And you will do this for 72 rows. You might be thinking to yourself, okay, I know how to count stitches, but how do I know where rows are? Good question. It is kind of hard to see. But if you stretch your work, those you can see for yourself. There are gaping holes between your rows. 1, 2, and now we're on the third row. If you have a hard time counting, you can count how many rows you do, and then like put a little safety pin at the beginning of like the row you just did so you know how many you've done. You can do it in sections of 5, sections of 3, sections of 10, whatever's more comfortable to you. But learning how to count rows is important. Go ahead, continue this pattern until you have 72 rows, and then I will show you how to fasten off, which is basically the way that you quit making a particular piece and make it so it cannot come undone. And then we will make the part for the bow, and then we will put them together. So just keep working on that. Okay, I have my 72 rows of my single crochet, and it should look something like this. What you want to do with the last, this is like the end, very end of, this is the end of my row on the 72nd row. You will just go ahead and chain one, like we did when making the foundation chain. Put your hook under, pull it through once, and instead of leaving it on your hook, cut your yarn a good long ways down so you have a nice long tail, and pull your hook out. Then, when you pull that tight, you've knotted it off and it can't be undone. And that is the piece for your project. And now, just set that aside and go ahead and move on to making the bow section, which is done very much the same way. It's just a section we're going to add on to the section to make the headband look like a bow. So, tie your slip knot, put your hook in, and it says chain 11. So go ahead and chain 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And then we're going to work back the other way and single crochet in the second chain from the hook and in each chain across. So we skip the first one, go into that second one. We'll go ahead and single crochet all the way back across. And we will work this section just like the last section in multiples of 10 instead of 13 this time across, and you will do that for 12 rows. So go ahead and complete your section. This is my last stitch. I'm going to cut a whole long tail there and chain one and pull through to finish it off. And now what you basically have is one really long rectangle and one short rectangle. We're going to take that yarn darner or tapestry needle or whatever it was called when you bought it. They're all basically the same thing. And we're going to thread one of the long tails onto our needle. And we're going to pull the two short ends together. And we're going to stitch between the bottom loop of the foundation chain and the back loop of the single crochet at the top row. You're going to do that all the way across. Now, if you find that your tail is not long enough to make it all the way across, that's fine. I'll show you what you can do in that case. Even if my tail is long enough, I'll go ahead and show you what to do. Now, let's say my tail only made it this far. I would just take my needle and thread it through the stitches that I made and pull that tail through to hide it and trim off the end. That's what's called weaving in the ends and finishing. Then you can use the other side tail, or you can just cut a piece of yarn that's long enough. It doesn't matter. You can weave in the ends on anything, so you'll just do the same thing. Whip stitch all the way across. The reason why you want a long tail is because it can be near impossible to weave in the ends on a very short tail, and then you'll have these stubby little pieces sticking out. You can just weave over a weave that you've done before and then go ahead and weave into your stitches. Pull it tight. Wiggle it a little bit to make sure it's nice and settled in there and trim it off. And now you have woven in and seamed together your piece. If you find that there are ends on the other side that are sticking out, you can trim them off. And that is your basic headband all done. Now what you're going to do is take the bow section. And crinkle together your headband so that the bow can fit around. And it's okay that the wrong side is on the outside right now, because we can turn this later. And we're going to do the same thing that we did to seam together the headband, to seam the bow. And the great thing is that you can just slide this bow around wherever you want on the headband. So it's not like if you position it and you decide you don't like where you position it, there's nothing you can do about it. You can move it on down the bow, you can put it right in the middle, you can put it on the side, you can put it wherever you want, it will move around freely. When you weave in your ends, make sure you're getting in between stitches. That will ensure that they won't come out again. And you only got one more end to do. And this will be a finished project. You can just weave into any stitch. It doesn't have to, you can just be the closest ones. It doesn't have to be the ones in the seam. Like this one is a row of single crochet, and they will hold them in tightly because there's more of them still there. I haven't whip stitched them together. Now we'll just flip this part over in the back of the bow so we can't see it. And now you have a bow headband. And these are great stocking stuffers. If you decide you want your headband to have a little more finished look to it, you can also single crochet all the way around the edge before you put this on. Or you can put a different color on this, or you can put a button here. But now you have gone from not knowing how to crochet to making a headband bow. I hope this has been a useful tutorial for you. If you have any questions or concerns, or if I've made a mistake that you think I need to address, please do me a favor and comment here. I can also help those of you that are seriously stuck on Skype. So don't hesitate to let me know, and I will be posting the link to the second lesson in the beginner class in my description as soon as it is put together. I do advise practicing using these techniques for at least a week before moving on to the next lesson, because it kind of needs a little while to settle in your brain before you start adding more stuff onto it. Thanks a lot, and I'll see you guys next time.